participating in a tradition. There's an intergenerational thing between parents and children here that's being passed down. It's called tradition. Now, if I say tradition, what comes to your mind? Fiddler on the roof, okay? Now, I've said this before, and I'll say it again. When you graduate from Gordon College, everybody here that's going to graduate from Gordon College, you must watch Fiddler on the Roof. If you do not, Dr. Wilson will be there with one of these air gun things. And when you go across to get your diploma, man, he's going to pop you one. And so you better watch Fiddler on the Roof before you graduate here. He knows who's watched and who not. Okay, he knows. So anyways, I'm just kidding, but I do recommend the movie and stuff. It's one of those phenomenally good movies. But tradition what? From the parents to the children, from the parents to the children, and the traditions passed down through generations and generations. By the way, in our culture, is tradition usually a negative thing? We want to break out of tradition and things like that. Here, you see this being passed down from generation to generation. The land is a gift that's passed down and things. Now, the land is a gift. We've said that about 10 times already. The land is a gift. God is giving the land. They don't deserve it. They don't deserve it. God is giving them the land as a gift. This gift shows God's choice in loving them. Let me just read chapter 7, verse 7. The Lord did not set his affection on you and choose you. So he set his affection and he chose you. Does God choose to love somebody? Can you choose to love somebody? Is love a choice? No, it's just the chemistry. You get around this person, it just makes me feel, okay, no. Is love a choice? Here we get this thing. The Lord did not set his affection on you and choose you because you were more numerous than other peoples. For you were the fewest of all peoples. But it was because the Lord loved you and kept an oath he swore to your forefathers that he brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the land of slavery. God chose you. And that's what's significant and makes you special. It's a good land. It's a land flowing with milk and honey. We said that phrase, this phrase, milk and honey, is a real famous phrase and stuff. Milk is probably what kind of milk? Goat's milk. The honey is possibly honey for bees, but it's also possibly date jam. It's been mashed up and stuff. It's a land that's filled. It's filled with cities. It's filled with wells. It's filled with gardens. They didn't build the cities. They didn't dig the wells. They didn't plant the gardens. God's going to give them this filled land, and the land is going to be a satisfying land. And what's the problem going to be? When they eat and are satisfied, what's their problem? They're going to forget the Lord their God, and that's going to be a big problem. So the land is a satisfying land, and Moses is looking over there. Can you see Moses up on Mount Nebo drooling and just saying, man, I wish I could go into the land. I've been out in the desert for 40 years, man. This stinks out in the desert. And here these people are going to go in and eat all these grapes and, you know, olives and pizza and all sorts of stuff. So anyways, now, chapter 12 is a really important chapter. And actually, chapter 12, you could talk about for hours and stuff. God says to Israel, Moses is up here on Mount Nebo. Moses tells them that God is going to pick a place in Israel and that God is going to put his name in that place. And so this chapter 12, verse 5 is a kind of a classic thing, but the whole of chapter 12 says this, but you are to seek the place the Lord your God will choose from among all your tribes to put his name there for his dwelling. Where would God put his name in Israel and dwell there forever? What place would that be? Originally it went to Shiloh, right? The tabernacle went up to Shiloh, but is that where it stayed? No, David is going to bring it down to Jerusalem, and is Jerusalem now going to be the city of David and the city of our God? Jerusalem now will be the city of our God, and God will put his name in Jerusalem. The temple will be built in Jerusalem, and God will put his name there. And so Jerusalem becomes, and so this, what you have in Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse 5, is the centralization of Israel's worship, foreshadowing what was going to happen here with Jerusalem. And by the way, is Jerusalem considered a holy city till this day? Is Jerusalem till this day is considered a holy city and Lord's presence there. Now, major problems. Major problem for Israel that Moses warns them about is that basically forgetting where you come from. Where did Israel come from? They were slaves in Egypt. They were slaves in Egypt. And Moses warns them. He says, don't forget where you came from. Be careful. Do some of you have memories of where you came from that you would love to forget? I told you my son got back from Afghanistan. When he got back, when he was out in Afghanistan, he was shot at every day. He saw friends take hits. Some of his friends were blown up, blown up smithereens. Rez, one of his friends that he trained, was blown 100 feet in the air, 100 feet in the air, and fell down, broke almost every bone in his body. He lived, and the problem is that my son says that when he goes up and talks to him, he says, Rez is not there, you know what I'm saying? When he got shot up like that 100 feet in the air, something happened to his head, and it's not Rez anymore, you know what I'm saying? If you fell 100 feet, that's 10 stories. If you jumped out of a 10-story building, it's a long way to fall. And so Rez has got all sorts of, Rez is not Rez anymore kind of thing. His head's been busted up really bad. He's still alive, though. And what I'm saying is, my son got back, he was telling all these stories, and we said, man, Ellen, you got to write these things down. And actually, I've got the first one that he wrote now. He's actually written one of them down. Turned into an English assignment over at North Shore. And his comment to me was, Dad, he says, I've seen stuff that no human being should ever see. He says, I want to forget it. He says, I never want to remember it. I don't want to remember it ever again in the rest of my life what happened. I want to try to forget it. A question, is it good to forget some stuff? And I think it may be. What's the problem with forgetting? When you try to forget, is it still in you? What happens is it integrated in, or when you try to forget it, do you just dismiss it? But can you forget stuff like that? You can't forget this stuff. Will it pop up at certain times then if you don't integrate, if you don't take care of it? And so what I'm saying is it really good to talk about these things and integrate these things in, rather than rejecting and just forgetting everything, is to integrate them into who you are? Is this part of who he is now? That's part of his history now. And he has to own that, as much as it's terrible and it is really bad. And I don't know how you do all that, but I know that it doesn't do any good to suppress it and to forget it. You've got to integrate it. And so all of us have certain parts of our past that we wish we could forget. And what I'm saying is, be careful about forgetting. Remembering and integrating is probably the way to go. It makes integrating and remembering leads to a more mature person. If you forget, then you get these real weird stuff happening. But sorry, okay, let's get off that. On remembering, on the other hand, remembering, God tells them they are to remember the what? The house of bondage. They were slaves in Egypt. Remember that you were slaves. That's a bad memory for them. But God says, remember you were slaves because I delivered you out of that slavery. Redemption. You came out of Egypt. You crossed the Red Sea. Remember God's deliverance with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Do you remember reading that a number of times? God said, I brought you out with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. God is the deliverer. God is the deliverer, and God is the place that they should put their faith and trust. God is the one who redeemed them out of Egypt, out of the slavery and their bondage in Egypt. So God tells them to remember. And remember, by the way, does anybody know the Hebrew term? Is anybody named Zachary in here and stuff? Zachar? Zachar means to remember. And so I have a son, Zachary, and he was named that because he's been true to his name, Zachary, remember, and stuff, Zachariah. So anyway, it's okay. Remembering then is a basis for praise. Remembering is a basis of praise. Do you guys remember things where you met God and God did wonderful things in your life, and you use that memory then causes you to come back and praise God? So memory is a basis for praising God. They were to remember that they were brought out of Egypt with a mighty hand. The Red Sea split and they came across. God provided manna from heaven. God brought them to Mount Sinai. And at Mount Sinai, God, in a certain sense, married Israel. In Mount Sinai, God gave Israel his covenant and promised himself, and they promised themselves to each other. And God married them, and so to speak, in Sinai. And then God took them in a 40-year wilderness wandering. It was kind of like a honeymoon. And now God is taking them into the land of promise. God is bringing his bride home to the land that he promised to them, and he wants them to remember. Remember is a basis of praise. By the way, when you get into the book of Psalms, is there all sorts of memories of Israel's history floating through the book of Psalms? Psalm 78, the whole thing is all these remembrances of the stuff that you guys have just been reading. Is Psalm 78, all these things, for a steadfast love endures forever. Psalm 136, again, full of all Israel's history, coupled with God's steadfast love forever. The basis of praise, the whole book of Psalms is based on this. So, reflective questions. Where do you dwell? And what do you remember? And does your memory become a basis for praise? Now, do you experience the presence of God in the where in which you live? Do you experience the presence of God at Gordon College when you're in Lane, when you're in various places? Just before I came to class, I was walking down some steps in Frost Hall. And as I was walking down the steps, a man named Bruce came up. And as Bruce came up the steps, question, did that cause God to come into my mind to think about Bruce in relationship to God? Yeah. Bruce has got cancer. Bruce has got cancer. Question, do I need to be praying for him? I need to be praying for him. And so I see Bruce and it calls me to the throne of God to say, God, be merciful. Okay? And so, okay, so remembering and experiencing the presence of God in the where of which you live.